My name is Irene Gallego Romero.
All right, and what are you an expert in?
I'm an expert in human evolution and human evolutionary genetics in particular. That's what I study and that's what I'm really interested in.
All right, and are we alone in the universe?
I can't imagine we are. The universe is too big. And there's just too many stars, too many planets we keep discovering. Whether we'll ever meet anybody else in the universe, that's a different question. But I just cannot imagine we are alone in the universe.
So you think we're not alone?
I do not, no.
All right. And what is the rationale behind that? Why do you say that?
I just think there is, again, too many stars. The universe is so big. And I think ultimately there is no way. It's so unlikely to me that we could be the only planet around the only star with life evolved. What that life looks like? No idea.
So in this question that I asked, are we alone? What does the word we mean to you?
We? Oh, that's actually a good question. I guess usually it probably means humanity, but it could just mean anything on this planet. Is this the only planet with life? I don't think so.
But if it were humanity, then it might be?
Something else. I don't know. I think my imagination is so limited by how we've lived so far that I cannot even conceive of what other things in the rest of the universe could be like. So whatever we'll never find other humans in a different planet. That much is an absolute given.
So then we are alone, you think?
In that sense, yes. Are there more humans? No.
No other humans, but other life, yes.
Yes.
Okay. How about other animals?
Probably. I would think so. Again,
plants,
depends.
Fungi?
Things. I don't know what they will look like. I have no idea what they will look like, but I cannot think we're the only living thing in this planet.
How about eukaryotes?
Eukaryotes? No.
How about multicellular organisms?
I don't know. I feel like we know so much about life on this planet that it's very hard for us to think about life, what life could look like otherwise. And so I'm probably not going to find eukaryotes, probably not going to find animals. Will there be something that perhaps looks like an animal, is equivalent to an animal? Probably yes.
Okay. And in astrobiology, we're trying to get a scientific understanding for who we are, how we got here. Do you think that's a worthwhile thing to do?
Absolutely. I mean, it's what I study in a very much smaller timescale, perhaps, but absolutely. I think it's a fascinating question and there's so much to learn from it.
And that's why you became a student of...
Human evolution. Yeah, it's because I'm super interested in human... So I'm interested in DNA and I'm interested in human evolution. I think together they're just the best, the most fun questions I can think of, really.
Now, are you an alien?
Am I an alien? No. Illegal alien.
You're a human being.
Yes.
Well, I'm a human being too. So, my ancestors, as you can look, see me, it probably came from Western Asia or Europe. Mm-hmm. And you are too.
Very much so.
How closely related are you and I?
How closely related are you and I? We probably share an ancestor, more than one ancestor in the past, I don't know, 500 years, 600 years.
So that would make us 10th cousins?
Something like that, perhaps. I'm really bad at counting, but yeah. 10th, 11th, 12th cousins. It was a small thing, Europe, a while ago.
Now, you have mitochondria and I have mitochondria, and you can make a maternal line tree of humans.
Absolutely.
And this mitochondrial Eve, mm-hmm. you've heard of. Can you tell us about that and what does that tell us about our origins?
So mitochondrial Eve is a complicated thing, actually. It's a very... The usual idea of mitochondrial Eve is this notion that she's the... Fine, she's the ancestor we all have in common. But that's actually a mistaken idea because she gets presented as the one ancestor we all have in common. That's not true. What happened is mitochondrial Eve was just the only one of our common ancestors. And when I say our, I mean every single human, who had an unbroken lineage of daughters all through time for the past 150,000 years or so. So mitochondria is inherited from your mother, and so you get it from your mother. I will pass it on to my children. But if you have
pass
a son
it on to, your daughters.
To my daughter, sorry, yes, very well. I'll pass it on to all of them, but only my daughters will pass it on.
Right.
And so, the mitochondrial Eve was not the only woman living at that time. She was one of many, and they all contributed to our existing genetic diversity. It's just that mitochondrial Eve, by chance, just happened to be the one who had an unbroken lineage of daughters until this day.
And there were people before her.
There was absolutely people before her, and she's just the most recent common ancestor of her mitochondrial DNA, but absolutely not the only common ancestor we all share. When? Between 200 and 150,000 years ago, depending on the dates that you trust.
And where did she live?
Somewhere in Africa.
Where?
We don't know that very well. Again, some people say it's East Africa, some people say it's South Africa. It's somewhere in between the Horn of Africa and the southern tip of Africa, but that's a very big space and it's hard to know where it happened there.
Well, the story that this mitochondrial maternal line tells us, how is that different or how is that similar to the Y chromosome paternal line?
So it's similar in the sense that, again, the paternal chromosome is inherited only by, so it's transmitted only from fathers to sons. And so it's a very easy way of tracing back your patrilineal lineage, but only that little bit of your genome. Again, it doesn't tell you much about the rest of your genome. And the same is true of mitochondria. They tell you a lot about a little bit of your genome, but they don't tell you a lot about your entire genome or you as a person.
Right, but what about Y chromosome Adam? When did he live?
Probably, it's different. That's
before
another date that's
after.
Harder. Same time-ish, more or less. But again, The confidence intervals are very big. So we might be saying 150 to 100,000, or again, 200 to 100,000, 200,000 to 150,000 years, more or less.
I thought that if there were polygamy, then a lot of males don't get to have offspring, and some males have lots of offspring, that would change the ages associated with mitochondrial Eve and Y chromosome Adam. Is that wrong?
It's not necessarily wrong, but it doesn't change that much in the sense that our common ancestors are from Africa. And so we've had a lot of time there to test out different marriage strategies and things like that. But ultimately, if you want to go back to the common ancestor we all share, you have to go back to the root of humanity, and that's in Africa.
Right. And that, now I've understood that modern humans came out of Africa about 80,000 years ago or so?
Oh, the dates again get funny, depending on who you talk to. So some people will, so we know for sure that humans were in Israel around 100,000 years ago, but then it seems they died out. The weather changed, so there was another global climate change event, and it became really inhospitable, and so they all died out. A second, third, whatever, another group of humans came out maybe 70,000 years ago, maybe 60,000 years ago. The numbers, once again, are a bit fuzzy, and they're the ones who spread all across Eurasia, all the way down to Australia, also into Europe, eventually crossing out of Northeast Asia through the Bering Strait into South America, North and then South America. Whether that was one wave of people, a few waves of people, and the dynamics of that are actually super complicated and something I find really interesting to study. It's one of the things I like to study.
So when you map the mitochondrial DNA story from the maternal line onto migrations, mm-hmm. and you do the same thing with the Y chromosome story onto migrations, mm-hmm. do those migrations map onto each other?
On the whole, so it's really hard to trace migrations in that way, I would say, or it's not very straightforward to track migrations. And what's worth keeping in mind is that that's only you're looking at a single data point in a 3 billion data set point. You're looking at a single data point in a data set of 3 billion points, so each of them is a single SNP or base pair in your genome. And so what they tell you is not necessarily representative of what happened, it's just what happened to that particular bit of DNA. So you can definitely see that Africans have a common ancestor in their mtDNA, and that mitochondrial DNA that exists outside Africa is a subset of all that exists within Africa. And the same is more or less true for Y chromosome data. So in that respect, yes, you can find the out of Africa in the mitochondrial genomes, and you can find the out of Africa in the Y chromosome data. You can find it in the rest of the genome too.
Well, how big, I mean, presumably you have to look at stretches of the mitochondrial DNA that vary pretty rapidly in order to trace something on a 100 or 200,000 year timescale. What do you have to know the name of
The hypervariable region.
The hypervariable region. That's what it's called.
That's what it's called, the HVS, HVR, yes.
And how large is that? Like
600 base pairs.
600?
So it's actually not very informative. So you're touching on a problem there. The region is very small. Mitochondria mutates really quick.
600.
So we do actually hit saturation. So this is why we've moved away from looking only at mtDNA. We want to look at the whole genome, because in the whole genome we have 3 billion bases we can mutate versus 600 base pairs we can mutate. And so the whole genome tells you a much more comprehensive picture than mtDNA. The beauty of mitochondrial DNA, sorry. Mm-hmm. The beauty of mitochondrial DNA is, of course, that it was very easy to access 10 years ago, 15 years ago, because we didn't have the technologies we have now. Now we have much more advanced technologies in terms of sequence. I can sequence a human genome in a day, in 2 days. Mm-hmm. Before, 10 years ago, I could sequence a mitochondrial genome in 1 day or 2 days. Mm-hmm. And that's partly why we focus so much on it. But once we got access to really the whole genome, it became clear that the picture of the mitochondrial toll was not the entire thing. It was just a very small picture of our bigger story.
Is how the part of the, presumably the same thing can be said about the Y chromosome. There are parts that are more variable than others.
Mm-hmm.
And so how big is the, how many base pairs is the equivalent hypervariable region of the Y chromosome?
So you've caught me in that one. I don't know the number specifically. I don't want to hazard a guess in case it's totally off. What I can tell you is that it's nowhere near the entire Y chromosome. Right. It's only a very small chunk of the Y chromosome that's informative.
More, larger or smaller
it's
more, than
It's definitely larger. It's larger.
It's larger, larger for than 600 sure. base pairs.
Yes.
Okay.
But it's subject to different kinds of quality control. And so it's stored in the nucleus of the cell. So it's less likely to mutate than mitochondria. Mitochondrial DNA, it's called mitochondrial because it's in your mitochondria, not in your nucleus with the rest of your genome. So there is no error proofing there. When we copy the mitochondria, which is whatever errors creep in, they creep in. Whereas in the Y chromosome, it's much more stringent quality control when the cells divided and replicated. And so there is, although there is a much bigger stretch of sequence to work with, the effective mutation rate or the effective information content is probably similar to that of the mitochondria.
Now, have you sequenced your own genome?
I haven't actually, no. I have to, so yeah. Okay. We once tried to get DNA out of me and we failed and then I just stopped.
Okay. Now, I did 23andMe and they told me what my mitochondrial DNA mm-hmm. was, and they said, that it, when I looked at the mitochondrial DNA tree, I see that the L3 is the one that went into Northern Europe, and then it was an N, and then it was a
N,
U or something.
N and M and U's, yeah, U.
Yeah,
is
the
very
U
common.
Went, the M's went to the
India.
East, and the N's
yep.
went north, and that's where my ancestors come from.
Yes.
Presumably, you will have something similar.
No idea.
Okay.
To be honest with you.
but I could ask myself something similar about the Y chromosome. Would I also have a particular subset of Y chromosomes that went migrated with these? I guess the L3s. That
so, I'm going to inject some nuance in that. You probably don't, or at least what you have probably bears the traces. Especially if your ancestors come from Great Britain or Scandinavia,
yeah.
They bear the traces of much more recent things like the Viking invasions into Great Britain.
But as far as the Vikings and the Britons, they're kind of like the same.
They're kind of like the same, but the time scales that we're talking about here are enough that you do get differentiation. We can tell a Viking Y chromosome, Scandinavian Y chromosome,
right.
really, from a British Y chromosome to some degree. Not with a lot of degree uncertainty. And again, it doesn't tell you a lot about yourself as a person. It just tells you, yeah, you have an unbroken line of paternal descent, but that's one of, you know, two parents, four grandparents, da 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 da. So it's one of very many ancestors who, yeah, was a Viking, but pretty much most of us in Europe have that, actually.
Now, I've noticed that human beings are not as hairy as other apes.
Mm-hmm.
So when did we lose our hair?
That's another question we have no idea about, because hair doesn't fossilize, so we can't really tell. So we know that
there's some way to look at lice and the different types of lice that speciate.
You can sort of, but it's still not so much. So what I can tell you probably happened in the last 6 million years. So 6 million years ago, we were not in the planet and neither were chimpanzees, but something that gave rise to both us and chimpanzees was alive at the planet at the time. It's an australopithecine. What that australopithecine looked like, well, we have some fossils, so we know it had a giant, well, there was a bunch of them, but we had very strong jaws. We can sort of guess what it liked to eat, how it liked to live. Did it live in trees? Did it run around the savanna? Did it have hair? Probably, because chimpanzees have hair too. And so probably it had hair, and we are the funny exception, the hairless ape. But when did we lose that hair?
You don't know, 1 million, 2 million, 3 million, 4 million?
I mean, I could tell you that it's probably around, I don't know, no, like, maybe 1 million, 2 million, but I'm just making up numbers on the basis of the things we were doing, as the sort of fossils we found from that time, stone tools and things like that we found from that time, suggest that we might have been known to, we were, you know, skinning animals and turning into clothes, and hair is pretty useful if you don't have clothes, right? So.
Well, can you look at the genes for hairiness and then compare Neanderthal genes to modern humans and say Neanderthals were more hairy or less hairy than we are?
You could, absolutely, but well, you could to a degree. We're very bad at understanding. So it's very easy for me to find a gene that says that gene makes hair. It's very hard for me to say that gene is only turned on your head and, you know, on the back of your hands or whatever. That part is still very tricky. So I can tell you Neanderthals had wonderful heads of hair. Yes, I can even tell you some of them had red hair. I cannot tell you, was it all over the place? Probably not. Highly unlikely.
So you can't identify the regulator during, I guess, puberty or something. That, or I guess, anyway, you can't identify the gene that regulates the hair producing genes.
So it's not so much the gene that identifies the gene regulation. It's the regulatory regions of the DNA, the bits that don't actually code for hair, but control when and where the hair is turned on, that I cannot, at this point in time, we cannot identify as easily.
Can't you take the full genomes of, let's say, 100 people and divide them into hairy, average hairiness, and very hairless, and then see what the differences are, like a metagenomic study?
You could try, but you need way more samples than that. A lot more. We're talking millions of samples.
Can you just like the hairiest person you know and the hairless person?
No, and the problem with that one is that the very... So if we're talking about a distribution of hairiness, so from super hairy to not hairy at all, the two people at the extreme of the distribution, they're very likely to be atypical cases. They're not gonna always share. It may well be caused by mutations. So for instance, really, really tall people and really, really short people, those mutations, those phenotypes are not caused necessarily by the same genetic variants that cause the normal distribution of height.
I see.
So I can't always tease out everything. The extremes sometimes are informative, but not always.
I see. Okay. How about female humans have menopause, and menopause is not very common, but do you know anything about the origin of menopause, when that might have started?
No, I can't tell you when, but I can tell you why we think it occurred, and from that we can sort of make haphazard guesses as to why, but it's very...
The grandmother hypothesis?
Yeah, so the numbers are hand-wavy, but the hypothesis itself is also a bit hand-wavy, but it's very hard to reconstruct behavioral things like that, or to test behavioral hypotheses like that, I think, with the tools we have.
Oh, well, can't you just compare a human genome to a female human genome to a female chimp and say, okay, in humans, there's a gene that turns off ovulation at a certain stage of life? You can't find those?
Not necessarily, no. It's a lot harder than that. Again, there isn't a single gene for any of these things. It's very much all these traits that we're discussing are the product of many, many genes acting in concert. Mm-hmm. So each of these genes will have a very small effect on the trait. So if I can scan the genome of a human and chimpanzee, and I do that a lot, actually, for differences, but what those differences mean... And how those differences come together to give you an ultimately such a big difference, a big difference between a human and a chimpanzee, that's a lot harder to predict. We are nowhere near able to read a human genome and say, well, that's, that means, this high and that color eye and this propensity for, eating salty foods or whatever. It's not quite there yet.
How about, I've recently found out that we have 23 pairs of chromosomes, mm-hmm. and all the other great apes have 24 pairs.
Yes.
And then they found out that, okay, 2A and 2B merged into the current human too. Do you have any idea when that happened?
So that happened again sometime in the last 6 million years. So
6 million.
and I can only tell you that because humans and chimpanzees have a common ancestor going back 6 million years.
Right.
So the chimpanzees have what we call the ancestral state. In this case, they do indeed share it with the gorillas and the bonobos and the orangutans, all the other great apes, that they have these two small chromosomes that we call 2A and 2B, whereas we have a single chromosome 2, which is massive.
But
right?
When 2A and 2B come together, isn't there something that went missing somewhere, that's a piece that's missing, that is missing in us, that the other great apes do have?
Not that we found, and it's also partly because those bits that join together are made, so the way the chromosomes join was the end of 2A, right, attaches to the end of 2B, and the ends of chromosomes are not actually very information rich, and they're very hard to sequence, as is the join point that we have now. And so we actually, we say we have the sequence of the human genome, there's bits and pieces missing still. We don't seem to, and so parts of what's missing is that join between what we call the centromere, where the two bits of the centromeres of the chromosome are stuck together. And so it doesn't seem like we lost anything important, no.
Why do you think the ends of the chromosomes would be information poor?
So I know they are, because that's where the telomeres are. So when we copy DNA, the problem of, and it's a big subject for a 2-minute conversation, right?
But no, but forget about the telomeres. Inside the telomeres, is that also information poor?
No.
Oh, so when information poor, you just talk about the telomeres.
I'm talking about the edges,
right.
Yeah.
All right. Now, a lot of people mistakenly think that we evolved from chimpanzees, mm-hmm. and we and chimpanzees evolved from a common ancestor.
Absolutely.
And people are very knowledgeable and concerned and focused on how we have evolved from the common ancestor.
Yes.
But I was wondering, what can you tell us about how chimps have evolved from that common ancestor?
Oh, I wish I could tell you more, because it's a fascinating question too. So there isn't much I can tell you. I can tell you that common ancestor we had was probably a tree-dwelling animal somewhere in between humans and chimpanzees that shared traits with both of us. It's very hard to find fossil chimpanzees, and that's because they live in the forest. So you have to, and fossils don't get very preserved in wet environments like a forest. And beyond that, even if they did, we just haven't had the chance to find those fossils.
Well, how about genetically? Because you can use gorillas as an outgroup, mm-hmm. and then you can compare humans and chimpanzees and then say, okay, here was the genome of the common ancestor. Yep. And therefore, you can tell which changed along this lineage and which changed along the other. So what were those changes along the chimp lineage?
There's a lot of so I can tell you most of them are pretty boring. So 99% of the coding, so of the genetic sequence, not the genome, but the bit of the genome that codes for genes is identical between humans and chimps. The majority of changes that matter are outside gene. So the sequence of the genes is the same. What changes, again, is the timing of the genes. How often do you turn that gene on? Where do you turn that gene on? How much of that gene do you make? And those changes, again, are still very hard to understand when we just simply look at a genome sequence.
Are you talking about epigenome then?
No, I'm just talking about gene regulation.
Wasn't that what epigenetics is
so
all
epigenetics
about?
is a fraught word. So, there is multiple definitions of epigenetics, and to me it means a different thing. To me, it mostly means modifications onto the DNA. So what I'm saying is that the genome of any mammal contains a very small fraction of that genome actually codes for proteins. Most of it is either non-functional or non-coding, but functional, and it controls when we turn genes on. Mm-hmm. That's where the differences are, and that's the bit we're still not quite there at interpreting just from looking at sequence data.
So if I ask the question, so often you'll read, we only have 1% difference mm-hmm. between us and chimpanzees.
Absolutely.
So most of that 90% of that 1% is on regulation, and so only 10% of that 1% would be...
So it's even worse. So that 1% number that you hear is the gene sequence. If you look outside the gene coding sequences, you will find more differences on that. Uh-huh. But the 1% number comes mostly from the gene sequences.
Okay, so let's talk only about those gene sequences then.
Okay.
So what gene sequences have varied between the common ancestor and modern chimps?
Quite a few, but most of them not in very interesting ways or so far. And it's very hard to test if the difference you see at the sequence level means anything at the biological level, right? So many, there might be differences, but it might well be that the function that gene A does and gene A is different between human and chimp can also be done by gene B. And so then gene B comes and makes up for the difference in gene A. So it gets really complicated and really hard to tease out if you only have sequence data. And this is, in fact, sort of some of the work I like to do is actually trying to go beyond that sequence and let's work out, we see differences. I mean, if I take a human liver and a chimpanzee liver and I compare them, there are differences. Absolutely. What causes those differences and how does this difference actually arise? Super hard to tell. I cannot tell you right now, even though that's the thing I study.
So you're doing metagenomics of humans and chimps then?
So I'm doing what's known as functional genomics instead, where we try to understand how it works.
Okay. Let's see. We're almost finished. Let's see. Have you seen any alien movies? Do you have a favorite alien movie?
Oh man, I watched The X-Files all the way through my childhood.
The X-Files, okay. X-Files.
Big deal.
And do you think the truth is out there?
Yeah, but perhaps not in the way they showed it at the end.
Okay.
That show went downhill.
Have you ever seen a UFO?
I haven't seen a UFO. And I tried as a teenager, but I've never seen a UFO, no.
What'd you do, go out in the woods in the dark?
No, X-Files was my life. So.
Really? X-Files was your life?
Absolutely. Wow. Dana Scully was a massive inspiration, I think, for me and for a lot of other women.
Scully?
Fantastic inspiration.
Was she in love with Mulder?
No, for the most part, she was right. And she was a fantastic and independent woman who had a career and success, and she believed in science, and she was a total badass.
Now,
and she had a gun.
Have you seen the movie Contact?
Yes, okay. And I read the book.
In that movie, several times, the main character is asked, are we alone? And mm-hmm. At the end, she says, if we are, it's an awful waste of space.
Yes.
What do you think of that comment?
I think it's absolutely true. I mean, I'm a big fan of Sagan, of Carl Sagan, mm-hmm. right? So I agree with that.
I think it's absolutely so. If the universe does not have hominoids in it?
No, if the universe doesn't have anything that's sophisticated in it, that's a big waste of space. I think as a species, we have some great things going for us, but I do like to think that perhaps this is not the best the universe can eventually cough up.
Okay, and do you have any advice for students who are thinking about becoming astrobiologists?
Goodness, do I? Yes and no, I guess. I have advice for students, who want to pursue the sciences, right? Which is that you can absolutely do it and it's absolutely worth it. I don't think I know enough about astrobiology to give very focused advice, but my advice is always, you can absolutely do it.
Do you think, what about the misconceptions that you see in people about aliens and
Well, it depends on your personality. I enjoy talking trash about movies that make mistakes in the science. Absolutely, it's a fun pastime. But I also, there comes a point where I just turn on the TV and say, I can't, and this is too much.
Well, how about the X-Files then? You watched it so much. What do you think was the craziest, stupidest idea that you inculcated by watching X-Files so much?
Oh my goodness. I like to think I've purged them all. I've forgotten all the bad things and I've only kept the good things. But I can tell you that, you know, I got into this field through Jurassic Park.
Jurassic Park.
Jurassic Park was the gateway drug for me into genetics. So Jurassic Park has, you know, the notion. And I know it's never going to happen. It's impossible to make dinosaurs out of. We are never going to find dinosaur DNA. But it was a cool idea.
Will we ever have Homo erectus DNA?
Yes, I think we're very close to getting that genome. And that's because they were around for a lot longer than we think.
So this year, next year?
Next 5 years, for sure. I don't know exactly when, but next 5 years, I would imagine.
So do you think you and I have Homo erectus genes in us?
You and I probably don't, but people who have been, people who are descendants of East Asians and islands of East Asia probably do a little bit.
So it's okay with you if I call them Homo sapiens erectus?
I'm not sure what that phrase conveys.
It conveys that they're a subspecies, not a sub.
No, they're not a subspecies. That definition is very tricky. We're all humans. That's all there is to it.
Well, we could interbreed with them, presumably.
Oh, sorry, you mean the erectus. You're not talking about the Asian.
I'm talking about Homo erectus. Sorry. Can I call Homo erectus Homo sapiens erectus?
No.
Why not?
Because so even though we might have had a couple of fertile kids with them, enough that the DNA has arrived, I think it's pretty clear that it was not a consistent, let's try again, sorry. I don't think you can, no. And that's because the concept of species is very tricky, but we generally, one of the things we define it in biology is that they have fertile offspring consistently. Mm-hmm. All of these admixture events we've seen with Neanderthals, with Denisovans, with potentially with erectus, which again is still on the line whether it happened or not, they show evidence of not having consistently given rise to fertile offspring. So there is, it's kind of possible to have a kid that is half, at some point, somebody who was half human, half Neanderthal happened. But it doesn't mean that was always going to work. And it's the same thing when you made a tiger and a lion. Yeah, they'll have a wonderful cat. It's a liger or a tigon. But it doesn't mean that tigers and lions are the same species at all.
How about bonobos and common chimps?
Bonobos and chimps are still separated sister species. They're closely related too, but they're still, bonobos are their own thing and chimpanzees are their own thing.
But I heard that they can hybridize.
Yeah, bonobos. Yeah.
Was that?
Bonobos.
Yeah. Bonobos.
They can do that, but it's still, they're...
Fertile? Are bonobos fertile?
I don't think they are, no. I believe they're not.
But you're not sure?
I'm not sure, but I believe they're not.
Okay, and are we alone?
No.
And why?
Because the universe is just too big.